Also to record. So today we shall look at moment generating functions, moment generating functions. The other time we described what moments were, and we said that, or rather we looked at two basic moments, the mean mu and the variance sigma squared. So today we want to look at moment generating functions. So in other words, we will get an expression which will help us to get the moment, that is to get the mean and to get the variance. So just to remind ourselves, we already are aware of two moments. Which ones? Mu, one of them, the mean mu, the mean mu, and the other moment is the variance sigma squared. So these are the two moments we usually discuss most of the time. Most of the time, we usually talk about, okay, something is happening to my screen. It is just black. What has happened? My computer. Oh, I'm back. Sorry for that. I don't know what happened. It just became black. Otherwise, today we want to look at the two moments mu and sigma squared. There is something we know about mu. We know that what we've covered so far, we know that the population mean mu is given by expectation of x. And we also saw in our previous lecture that sigma squared can be obtained by expectation of x squared. Expectation of x squared minus mu squared. Mu squared. Now we want to look for moments, or rather functions or expressions that enable us to get mu and sigma squared. So generally the moment generating function, which most of the time moment generating function, I've written it in short, MGF, moment generating function. And also sometimes, most of the time you'll see as writing just as small MGF, MGF, moment generating function. It is usually denoted by MX of T. M subscript x of t. We usually just say mx of t. So anytime you read a text and you see mx of t, then just know that it's referring to the moment generating function. So either we say mx of t or we say mgf. Now, so this moment generating function is what we shall use to obtain the mean, mu, or the variance, sigma squared. So we use mx of t, where t usually t ranges from 0, 1, 2, and it goes on. I know sometimes you may want to read some textbooks and you will see some things. So the values of t start from 0 and they go on. They can go on. So this mx of t gives us the moment generating function. It gives us a function. So once we have that function, then once we get an mx of t, once we get our moment generating function, then we can note this, that once we have our mx of t, then when we get m prime x of 0, x of 0, this will give us expectation of x, which is actually equal to mu. So in other words, I'm saying that is it expectation of mu? No, expectation of x. Sometimes we say something and we write something else. That is expectation of x. Maybe I was just anxious to write that it is equal to mu, the first moment. So if we get m prime x of 0, of course we know that prime refers to the first derivative, then and I hope my screen is visible to everyone. So if we get m prime x of 0, then actually we shall have found the first moment, which is mu. We shall have found the first moment, which is mu. Now, and then when we get m prime prime, x of zero, we shall have found expectation of x squared. We shall have found expectation of x squared. So what is that telling us? Recall remember that sigma squared is expectation of x squared minus mu squared. So using moment generating function technique, actually we usually call it technique, then it means that sigma squared, will be, in terms of moment generating functions, sigma squared will be given by m prime prime m prime prime x of 0 minus. So why have I put m prime prime x of 0? Because sigma squared is equal to expectation of x squared, but expectation of x squared is m prime prime x of 0. Now, sigma squared is expectation of x squared minus mu squared. And so, and we've seen that mu is m prime x of 0. So it will be minus m prime, the first derivative, m prime x of 0 and the whole quantity squared. Because variance is expectation of x squared minus mu squared. So in terms of moment generating function, sigma squared is mx, m prime prime x of 0 minus m prime x of 0, everything squared. So we need to note this one, equation one, important for getting the mean mu, and equation two for getting the variance of the variance sigma squared. So anytime we are given a function, we will get the moment generating function, then to get the moments, that is mu and sigma squared, we shall substitute in these two equations. So with that introduction, then let us define MGF. Now we can define MGF. We want to say what MGF is. Definition MGF. The MGF of a random variable capital X. The MGF of a random variable capital X having PMF, or PDF having PMF or PDF f of x or PDF f of x is given by mx of t mx of t is equal to expectation of e raised to tx which is equal to we introduce our big curly bracket. It is equal to integral e raised to tx f of x dx. We know how we usually get expectation, f of x dx. That is, if x is continuous, then we integrate or it is equal to summation e raised to tx f of x. So whenever we deal with random variables, we always remember that we have the continuous case and the discrete case. So mx of t, which is equal to expectation of e raised to tx, that is the moment generating function, the general formula, is equal to integral e raised to tx f of x dx if we are considering the continuous case, and it is equal to summation e raised to tx f of x if our random variable is discrete. If our random variable is discrete. So let us look at examples. Let's look at examples. We see how we can use these moment generating functions. Okay, so our first example, obtain mu and sigma squared. Obtain mu and sigma squared using MGF technique. Obtain mu and sigma squared using MGF technique, given that f of x is equal to, given that f of x is equal to v raised to x p raised to x 1 minus p raised to 1 minus x when x takes values 0 and 1. X is taking values 0 and 1 only, and it is 0 otherwise, elsewhere or otherwise. So you can write that elsewhere or otherwise. So we want to obtain mu and sigma squared by using the moment generating function technique, given that PMF. So x is taking discrete values 0 and 1. So we know that we are going to perform summation. So our moment generating function, we need to get the moment generating function first. After that is when we shall differentiate it. So our mx of t, because x is a discrete random variable, then we shall sum over the x values. What are the x values? X is 0 and 1. X is 0, 1. Summation e raised to tx, e raised to tx multiplied by the PMF. PMF, what is our PMF? P raised to x one minus p raised to 1 minus x . So we need to perform this summation over two values of x, x taking value 0 and x taking value 1 . Okay, so let's perform that summation so that we get our moment generating function So this is equal to what happens when x is zero. I will just try to be slow on this. So when x is zero, this is e raised to t times zero. Let me put it in brackets. T times zero, p raised to power zero. One minus p raised to power one minus zero. That is what happens when x takes value zero. And we are performing a summation. We are performing a summation. So we have substituted for values of x when x is zero. And since we are performing a summation, then plus, now we substitute for values of x with 1. We substitute for values of x with 1. So that is e raised to t, x is 1. So there's no need of writing it. And then p is also now raised to 1 because x takes value 1. And what about 1 minus p? 1 minus p will be raised to 1 minus p will be raised to 1 minus 1. That is when x takes value 1. So this is equal to e raised to 0 is just 1. P raised to 0 is 1. And then we have 1 minus p. 1 minus p plus, okay, here we have e raised to t. We have p e raised to t, p e raised to t, p e raised to t. That is e raised to t, p, and then 1 minus p raised to 0. 1 minus p raised to 0, any number raised to 0 is just 1. So actually, this is our moment generating function. So we have obtained our moment generating function. So to get the mean, we need to differentiate the function once, and then we substitute for t with 0. We need to differentiate it once. According to equation 1, we differentiate the function once, and then we substitute for t with 0. So let us get the first derivative, m prime x of t. M prime x of t will be equal to we are differentiating with respect to t. So this will just be equal to p e raised to t. It will be equal to p e raised to t. So now we can get mean. We were asked to find mu. We can get mean. And we know that the mean is given by m prime x of 0, m prime x of 0, and this is equal to where there is t, we put 0, so mu is just p. So mu is just p. Now we want to get variance. And to get variance, we know that we need m prime prime x of 0. We need m prime prime x of 0. So we need to get the second derivative of m x of t. the second derivative of the moment generating function. So we get m prime prime x of t. M prime x of t is p e raised to t. M prime prime x of t will just be the same value. We are differentiating with respect to t again. And if we substitute for t with zero, then m prime prime x of zero will be equal to p. So now we can get the variance. We can get the variance by substituting in equation two. So variance is equal to m prime prime x of zero, which is p, minus m prime x of zero squared, and that is p squared. So this is equal to p into 1 minus p. It is p into 1 minus p. So the variance is given by p into 1 minus p. So I can just mention that you'll find in some books, they will write PQ. PQ. So in some statistics books, this part, this portion, 1 minus P, in some statistics books, you'll find it is denoted by Q. So even if you find that they write that as PQ, there is no contradiction. We are just discussing the same concepts. So that is the first example. We look at another example. That is the first example. We look at the next example. So I can wrap this since I can see there are no queries, but let me just look at the chat before I wrap it. Just look at the chat before I wrap it. Okay. So we can continue. Now we want to get again mu and variance for, of course, using MGF technique for this PMF f of x is equal to e raised to minus lambda raised to power X. Over x factorial and x will be ranging from 0, 1, 2, and so on. 1, 2, and so on. Three dots. So again, we can see that this one is again a PMF. It is a PMF. So again, the moment generating function mx of t is equal to expectation of e raised to tx and because we are dealing with a PMF, then this will be summation e raised to tx f of x, and where we have f of x, let's just put our function e minus lambda raised to power x over x factorial . So, you know, we shall sum over the values of x, and you know, x takes values 0, 1, 2, and so on. So we need to perform this expansion as we are summing. Now, e raised to minus lambda is a constant, so I will factor it out. Let me denote it in. Oh, there's a question in the chat. I look at that first. Okay. Bill is asking, in these problems, do we need to keep checking that summation f of xi is equal to 1? No. You will only check or confirm if you are asked to do so. Because I can easily ask you to check whether it is a PMF or if it is a PDF. So if I ask you to check that, in other words, I'm asking you to find out whether it represents a probability. Because if you sum over x, you should get 1. And yes, I can ask you to confirm that it is a PDF or a PMF by showing that the summation is equal to 1. But we are not discussing that right now. We discussed that some time back when I introduced PMF and PDF. Right now, we are on something totally different. It's not about checking for PMF or PDF. Now we are talking about moment generating functions. So I was saying that we are performing summation over x for all this. And I said that we factor out e raised to minus lambda, because it is independent of x, then we shall remain with summation of e raised to tx over, sorry, e raised to tx lambda raised to x all over x factorial, all over x factorial. So what is that summation? It will be e raised to minus lambda when x takes value 0, what do we have? E raised to 0 is 1, lambda raised to 0 will be 1 over 0 factorial. Of course, we know that 0 factorial is just 1, but let me just write it. What is the next term? When x will take value 1, what are we going to have? E raised to power t. When x is 1, e raised to power t multiplied by lambda over 1 factorial. When x is 2, when x is 2, what will happen? We shall have e raised to power 2t over, multiplying by lambda what? When x is 2, lambda squared over 2 factorial. Let's just do the third one. When x is 3 plus, when x is 3, it will be e raised to 3t lambda raised to power 3 over 3 factorial. And then you know the summation continues indefinitely. So this will be equal to e raised to minus lambda into 1 plus lambda e raised to t plus lambda e raised to t squared over 2 factorial. Plus lambda e raised to t cubed over 3 factorial. So what we are doing actually, we are forming a pattern, and I'm sure you have come across this. So if you look at your SMP tables, there is this expansion which we have, which I want to use, the expansion of e raised to h is equal to, this is h, e raised to h is equal to 1 plus h plus h squared over 2 factorial plus h cubed over 3 factorial over 3 factorial plus up to infinity . So now we want to use that expansion to simplify our equation. So our equation becomes, equal to this equation. Our MGF is now e raised to minus lambda actually e raised to minus lambda and then e raised to what h is actually lambda e raised to t lambda e raised to t. So our moment generating function is equal to mx of t is equal to e raised to lambda is common e raised to t minus 1. So this is our moment generating function. So when it comes to MGF, it is very, very important to ensure that as you get the moment generating function, you don't incur any errors, because if you get the wrong moment generating function, then even if you differentiate it, you'll be differentiating the wrong expression. So it will not give you the correct answer. So now we have our moment generating function. And so we need to get the first derivative. So m prime x of t when you differentiate, you'll find that m prime x of t is equal to It will be equal to E minus lambda. Lambda E raised to T E raised to lambda E raised to T. So this is the first derivative of our moment generating function. So to get the mean, we just need m prime x of 0, m prime x of 0 which is equal to lambda. When we substitute for t with 0, we find that when we substitute for t with 0, it will be lambda, because that expression will cancel out with this other one. When t is 0, so we shall get lambda. So our mean is lambda. What about getting the variance? We need to find m prime prime, x of t, m prime prime, x of t, and that will be equal to, it will be equal to it will be d. Anyway, it will be equal to lambda E minus lambda open the bracket E raised to T E raised to T lambda E raised to T E raised to lambda raised to ET plus E raised to lambda E raised to T E raised to T. Okay, so it is that long expression. And so when we substitute for t with 0, we shall find that our m prime prime x of 0 will be equal to lambda E minus lambda open the bracket lambda e raised to lambda. Plus e raised to lambda. So then var x or sigma squared will now be equal to, our formula says m prime prime x of 0 minus m prime of x minus m prime x of 0 quantity squared. So this will be lambda e minus lambda into lambda e raised to lambda plus e raised to lambda, because that is m prime prime x of 0, and then minus m prime x of 0, what was it? M prime x of 0 was lambda, so that will be minus lambda squared. So when we simplify this expression, we shall find that this is equal to lambda. I can see there is a question in the chat. Okay, somebody's the E was not raised to lambda initially. So I don't know which E he's referring to, he or she. Let me just look at the chat again. I don't know which E my friend there is referring to, because I can't see the diagram very well. So Perez, I don't know which E is that. Perez, which E are you referring to? The E in which part, in which expression? Which E? Somebody's advising that you click on the image and it will be zoomed in. Perez has gone quiet. So another comment. Click on the image and it will be zoomed in. Which image? Wamono. I think I'm getting. Maybe it is the image on the chat. And now Brian has left. Why? Okay, let me click on this image. Ouch, you guys are clever. Okay, so which E? She was saying that E was not raised to lambda. Let me go back to the chat so that I get the question properly. The E was not raised to lambda initially. the E was not raised to lambda. Which one? Because I can see here, E is raised to lambda. E is raised to lambda there. So sigma squared will be equal to lambda. Maybe, okay, I think one way I can assist, we have, since I started writing, how many lines are these? One, the first one. The second one, the third one, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth. There's a new message. Oh, the E that came from the Taylor expression. Actually, in, yeah, who is this? I think this student is the one who has understood her question. Kembo, I think you are the one who has understood her question. This, and Kembo, what Kembo has said is right. What I have written here is the Taylor expansion. That is what I did not mention. I did not mention that I am using the Taylor expansion to substitute in, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, in equation 6. We are using the Taylor expansion. If you check in your SMP tables on page 9, we have the Taylor's expansion, which is given by E raised to H, which is equal to 1 plus h squared over 2 factorial plus h cubed over 3 factorial plus and so on. So this is known as the Taylor's expansion. It is the Taylor's expansion. And we are using this Taylor's expansion to simplify our MGF. So how did I do that? If you look at one, this one here, we have another one here. If you look at lambda e raised to t, it is behaving like h. And then here we have lambda e raised to t, everything squared. It is behaving like h squared over 2 factorial. That is why now our E minus lambda, which was outside the bracket in equation 6, our E minus lambda, which was outside the bracket, is the same one in equation, let me call it equation 7. It is the same one. And then, how come the quantity in brackets on equation 6, all of a sudden it looks like it's disappearing? It is not disappearing. We are substituting for it using the Taylor's expansion. So what is on the right of equation 6 is behaving like what is on the right in the Taylor's expansion. And the Taylor's expansion is telling us that what is to the right of it can be simplified as E raised to power H. So this one, it is E raised to power H. It is not E raised to power lambda or minus lambda. And that is why now when I come to equation 7, what is on the right of equation 6 can be written, instead of writing it as E raised to H, what we have seen is that the H in Taylor's expansion in equation 6, it is behaving like lambda E raised to T. So that is why in equation 7, I wrote E raised to lambda E raised to T. So everything which is on the right side of equation 6 has been simplified to e raised to lambda e raised to t. Why have we done that? By using the Taylor's expansion. I really hope that now it is clear to Perez, because I don't want to go on when somebody maybe is not clear about something. I hope now it is clear. And thank you, Kembo, for understanding her question. So yeah, that was very important, because if someone did not understand what happened between equation 6 and equation 7, they will not know how equation 8 comes about. And equation 8 is very, very important. Once you have equation 8, then you can get m prime x of t, and then you can get m prime x of 0. You can also get m prime prime x of t, and you can get m prime prime x of 0. And as I said earlier, it is very important to get the correct mx of t. It is very important to get the correct moment generating function. Now, what you'll realize, actually, from that question that has just been asked, let me take this opportunity to inform you in advance that you'll find that we shall be using some of the equations and formulae that you are taught in calculus right from year one. And that is why you are being taught some of those expansions, Maclaurin. In fact, there's a place we shall even talk about Maclaurin's expansion, and we shall use it. So we shall be using those functions and expressions you are taught right from year one in your mathematics classes. And this is one example of them. So if and when we find that we are using a previous expression or something, I will just take a minute or two to clarify or to remind you about it, so that all of us go on together. Okay, so with that explanation, then now, when we make the necessary substitutions, we find that variance is actually given by lambda. I know differentiation is not an issue. The most important part here is getting the correct moment generating function. Right, if there's no other question, or if there is no comment, then again, we shall look at another example. We shall look at another example. So I need to wrap this. Let me just wrap that. We continue with our next example. Again, we want to get the moment generating function given the following. PDF. Now we are given a PDF. F of x is equal to lambda e raised to minus lambda x. where X lies between zero and infinity. Zero and infinity, lambda is greater than zero. Lambda is greater than zero. And the other condition is that t is less than lambda. T is less than lambda, and then f of x is equal to zero otherwise. So we want to get the moment generating function for this. Otherwise, f of x is zero otherwise. We need to get mx of t. Mx of t. The moment generating function. Mx of t, which is equal to, we know it is expectation of e raised to x. Sorry, e raised to tx. And this is a PDF, so we know that we shall integrate. So it will be integral. The values of x lie between 0 and infinity. From the limits, we can see that the values of x lie between 0 and infinity. So it is integral e raised to tx. What is f of x? Lambda e raised to minus lambda x, and we shall integrate this with respect to x dx. So here you will be required to call upon your integration skills, and with correct integration, we should get lambda over lambda minus t. Lambda over lambda minus t. And so, this is our moment generating function. Mx of t will be given by this. So, we need to get m prime x of t, m prime x of t. And what is that equal to? It will be equal to lambda over lambda minus t squared. If we get the first derivative of our moment generating function. We will get lambda over lambda minus t quantity squared. So the mean, which is given by m prime x of 0, x of 0 this will just be equal to 1 over lambda when we put 0 in the position of t. So the mean will be 1 over lambda. And to get the variance, we need first to get m prime prime x of t. What will that be equal to? It will be equal to 2 lambda over 2 lambda over lambda minus t cubed. So m prime prime x of 0, x of 0 will be equal to 2 over lambda squared. Substituting for t with 0, we shall get 2 over lambda squared. And so what we are looking for, which is now variance, this is given by m prime prime x of 0, m prime prime x of 0, which is 2 over lambda squared. Minus 1 over lambda squared. And this is just equal to 1 over lambda squared. 1 over lambda squared. So I cannot see any more questions on the chat. Oh, there's a question, I think. Okay, somebody is asking about lambda always being greater than t. And my friend there, there's a reason. Okay, let me just explain a little bit these conditions. You see, it is only in this question that lambda, you are being told that lambda is greater than zero. If you are given another question, don't assume that it is greater than zero, unless you are told it is greater than zero. It is only in this question that you're being told that lambda is greater than zero. Now, in this question, t being less than lambda is very, very important. Why is it important? Because if If t is not less than lambda, then there could be a problem with that part. So when somebody has set a question, they give you conditions because they know that without those conditions, people may run into problems. Actually, that t being less than lambda is also important for your integration. It is very important for integration. When you will be integrating, you must remember that t is less than lambda. In a maths question, you're not given numbers or conditions or information which you will not use. You are given that information because the person who has set the question knows that without that condition, you may not be able to solve the problem. Without that condition, you may not be able to sort the problem. Is m prime x of t supposed to be squared when obtaining variance? Now, let me just write what I said when I was doing introduction to MGF. I said that when we are talking about MGF, we call MGF our moment generating function, we denote it by mx of t. And I said that the mean is given by m prime x of 0. So this means that to get the mean, you must first get the derivative, and then you substitute for t with 0. Now, when we want to get variance, when we want to get variance, what is variance? It is m prime prime x of 0 minus m prime x of 0 quantity squared. And that is exactly what I have done. Why am I saying that? Where we have sigma squared, this was equal to 2 over lambda squared. We had found that m prime prime x of 0 is 2 over lambda squared. Then in the next part, I'm supposed to substitute m prime x of 0 squared. What was our m prime x of 0? It was 1 over lambda. So here I have already squared it. I wrote it as 1 over lambda squared. Or you could have written it, you could have written this part as 1 over lambda squared. But me, I just squared it. So you could also have written it like that. But me, I just squared it. Let me look for another question. Other question?